Peter just worked much harder than normal on doing these characters, because Clive is very rigorous, and I think he was not in awe of Peter.
Well, I watch a great deal of television. I enjoy a lot of it. The Gladiator stuff, very, very good.
Yes.
That's about it, really. Yeah. I just watch that. All the shows.
And do you think that gives you a feeling for those?
Gives me a feeling of what it's like out there.
Yes.
I mean, I suppose the end result was not very different from two Cambridge undergraduates just fooling around, but, you know, both of us a bit older than that, but probably no more advanced.
Some would say he was the creative one of the three. I mean, without Jez, we would have just been a duo.
Yes.
I don't think you can see that that last programme he did with Clive Anderson without realising that here was a mind sparking still, damaged though it might have been by then, on all cylinders.
I've done a lot of drugs.
Yes.
I've done a lot of drugs, and I've slept with a lot of women.
Yeah.
And boys and girls at home don't.
Thank God he did it, because I was sick of telling people what a talent this man was. I don't want to look at him now. But you saw him in that programme, you saw the potential there. You saw the class act that he was, both as a writer and as a performer.
Because I'm telling you, I just got out of the Henry Ford Clinic. Yeah. And
Henry Ford Clinic?
Yes.
Not the Betty Ford?
No, the Henry one is a much tougher regime. Yeah. You have to build a car before you're allowed out.
Did my old heart go to see that happen to him before he died? I mean, that's at least re-established him. I said to another generation, look, stop it, this is what I can do.
And it was about that moment that I remember thinking, thank God, I think he's fine now. And I think that's the moment when I sort of almost stopped worrying about him.
Would you say that your career has largely been a failure?
Or a success, depends on how you look at the thing. Just toss it in the air, let it fall, you know not where.
Yes.
But I can look myself in the mirror in the morning and say, there is a man.
He obviously is a very extremely impressive comic figure of the English 20th century. But again, what always happens is that these things get sentimentalised.
Oh, thank you, I enjoyed that one very much.
He himself is a Rorschach ink blot onto whose vague and indeterminate shape other people project what they would like to exist. Cookie, the endearing invalid. Peter Cook, the extraordinary satirical genius.
We need a futile gesture at this stage.
Peter Cook, the comic inventor.
Football is about nothing unless it's about something, and what it is about is football.
And so on and so forth. But he was all and none of these things.
Sir Arthur, is it difficult to get ravens to fly underwater?
Well, I think the word difficult is an awfully good one here. Mm. Yes, it is. It's well nigh impossible, I think.
People would be less sort of promiscuously inventive about who Peter was if there had been more of Peter's own actual personality present. What there were these people who he created for himself to appear behind.
Sir Arthur, have you ever managed to get a raven to fly underwater?
No. I have never managed to get one to fly underwater.
Yeah.
Not at all. Not a single success in the whole 40 years of training.
Sounds rather a miserable failure, then, your whole life, really, I suppose.
Mm. No, this idea of him having wasted his life is... I mean, have you ever known a life as full as his? I mean, you just look at what he did over the years, and that would, to me, would be an absolute absurdity.
My life has been a miserable failure, yes.
Bollocks, crap, shit, nonsense. Thank you.
Peter Cook, the actor and satirist, has died in hospital of a stomach hemorrhage. He was 57.
Bloody hell.
My God, what a rigorous exam.
Mosquito and mosques.
Yes, I like it all.
The last time I saw Peter, not long before he died, was at his birthday party.
Is this what I've been good for all my life?
And looking back on it, it's rather marvellous, because Peter was absolutely at the top of his form. Almost like the Cambridge days that night.
It's very vulgar, isn't it? It's more like a little artist's bedroom than what I do.
So my last memory of him is a very happy one.
We are a dying race. We are becoming extinct.
You've only got to look at the line of Stephen Fry's and those sort of people who come afterwards to realise that he'd unlocked the door for anybody who was funny and was prepared to be funny about more demanding subjects than had hitherto been the province of comedians.
And now I see the sands of time are drawing all too rapidly to a close.
I kept his picture on my bureau for a long time, and then after a while I said, I can't. It was hard to keep him around.
I saw a girl huddled in the doorway. She seemed to be sobbing, and there was something about this frail little creature that drew me to her.
Sadly, at the time of his death, he actually was working extremely well again.
I was just explaining the ramifications of the community potato policy when I saw that her cup was empty. I went to the kitchenette and prepared another Nesquik, and when I returned, she was gone.
If you can say it about such an extraordinary career, there was an unfulfillment about that career as well. I mean, he achieved almost everything he could achieve, and yet I think he thought, and he was probably right to think, that he could have done more.
But I can look myself in the mirror in the morning and say, there is a man.
He just always had this ability to make anyone in his company fall about.
I loved his generosity of spirit, which was odd when he turned, because basically he was a good nut, you know? If you just realised it.
Tap, tap, tap at the bloody window pane.
He's always looking forward, and till the day he died, absolutely.
You know, it was a bloody Greta Garbo.
He was enchanting. He was a absolutely marvellous bloke to be with. I mean, he really was.
He was the drummer, was he?
That is vocal.
And when he died, I remember very clearly hearing the news. And normally when there was a crisis of private eye, Peter would appear on the door and then give a funny interview. And I was sort of expecting him to turn up, but then I realised he couldn't, because he'd died.
He's one of those guys that when you say, Peter Cook, like I'm talking to you now, and I slowly think, yeah, why am I doing this? He's dead. I mean, I never think of him as dead. You know, I just don't. Dudley too. I mean, they are, and it's sad, but I never, somehow, they didn't ought to die, did they?
I've got nothing against your right leg. The trouble is, neither have you.
To me, one of the magical moments of my life was knowing Mr. Cook. Oh, God, he made me laugh. More comedy as Kirsty Young joins Paul Merton to threaten Brazilian waxes and Britney Spears with Room 101 next.